Hello, everyone, and thank you for joining me on this inaugural episode of Hardware Corner here at Attack of the Nerds. On this show, I'll be covering hardware news that comes from both the PC side as well as the console side of gaming. If you're like me, you like finding out all the new details about a brand new piece of hardware and how you can use that to make your gaming experience even better. So without further ado, let us start. On today's episode, I'll be covering the release of several new processors, including Broadwell E, as well as Kaby Lake, Kaby Lake X, and Skylake X. In storage news, I'll be covering a brand new video card from AMD that also has a 1 terabyte SSD built onto it, as well as new external storage options for Xbox One players who also love Gears of War 4. In console news, I'll be covering the Nintendo NX, as well as the new Sega Genesis / Mega Drive Mini. Broadwell E released back in June of this year. As you can see, it's a beefy processor, just like we would expect from any Extreme Edition processor. We've got 10 cores with 20 threads with hyperthreading. We've got DDR4 support, 4 channels. We've also got 40 plus lanes of PCI Express 3.0. The graphic says 40, but I actually read somewhere that it is 44 lanes. We've also got 25 megs of cache built onto this new processor for the top of the line Broadwell E processor anyways. So as you can imagine, with any other Extreme Edition processor comes a hefty price, and this line of processor is no different. Here we've got the 6950X coming in at $1,723. Let me say that one more time, $1,723. That's almost $2,000 for a crazy powerful processor. Are you going to get your best bang for your buck with that? Probably not, but if you got enough money to lay down for this processor, then money's probably not an issue. Next in line, we have the 6900K coming in at $1,089. Getting tripped up on my numbers there. Below that, we have the 6850K coming in at $617. And then at the bottom of this list, we've got the 6800K, which is $434. If I were going to invest in a Broadwell E processor, it'd probably be that 6800K. That's closer to what I would normally pay for a processor. However, $434 is still kind of high for me, but I would at least consider it at this price point. Along with Broadwell E release, we've got news that Kaby Lake has started shipping to PC system builders. So what this means for us is that manufacturers like Dell and probably HP and other manufacturers will get their hands on Kaby Lake first. And then Intel will release these processors to other markets for those of us who like building our own processors. So we'll see that probably closer to the end of this year, and then a release after, shortly after that, for those of us who want to build our own Kaby Lake systems. Along with Kaby Lake, we have news of Kaby Lake X and Skylake X. For those of you who are not familiar with the X series, it's actually the Extreme Edition. I guess they decided to change the nomenclature for the Extreme Edition with Skylake and Kaby Lake X. There's a little confusion, at least there was for me, when reading about Kaby Lake X and Skylake X. So, to back it up, Skylake came out first, and now we've got Kaby Lake getting ready to come out here. And Kaby Lake is the upgraded version of the Skylake architecture. So when I was reading the information about Kaby Lake X only coming in with 4 cores, as opposed to Skylake X that's coming in with 3 varieties, 6, 8, and 10 cores, I didn't understand why the previous version of the Extreme Edition processors for Skylake came out to be a little bit more powerful than Kaby Lake X, which is the upgraded version of Skylake. I know it's a little confusing, but the graphic will probably help clear that up for you. So here's what's going on. The idea is that Kaby Lake X is, of course, a more optimized version of Skylake. So even though we have a reduced number of cores available for it, the performance difference may not be as big as opposed to Skylake, but I'm not really sure how far I can take that logic, because 4 cores versus 8 cores, I don't need to do the math for you. And of course, if we're talking about 10 cores, that's self-explanatory. But Skylake X will probably be the one that everyone goes for. It's got the better Turbo Boost technology. Of course, if you're using an Extreme Edition, you're probably doing manual overclocking and not using the Turbo Boost, so that may not be that big of a deal. They'll both be running on the same platform, and that's the Basin Falls let me get back to the right information. There we go. The Base and Fall series of motherboards. It was initially created to support Kaby Lake X, and of course it's got backwards compatibility. And maybe not backwards compatibility, but inline compatibility with Skylake X. And the reason why I say that is that both Kaby Lake and Skylake X processors will be released at the same time. We'll see those at either Q3 or Q4 of 2017. It'll be interesting to see how this works out with both of them being released at the same time. I mean, they're both extreme editions of each version, but I don't understand why they're releasing them both at the same time. If I had to guess, probably time and money has something to do with it. We'll find out more as we get closer to the release of both of those processors. Bear with me as I fumble through all my graphics here. So, the crazy AMD GPU with a 1 terabyte SSD built onto it. Insane. So as you can imagine, this GPU is not a standard consumer level video card that we would use for gaming. This, I think, is geared towards developmental work for, say, Hollywood movies and TV shows, as well as game development. The idea behind having a 1 terabyte SSD built onto your video card is access time. So, give a real basic breakdown of how things normally work. You've got your video card doing all your rendering, and of course it's got to talk to your hard drive to pull up new files and to store files that it's just got done processing. So with having a 1 terabyte SSD built onto the GPU already, that cuts down on the amount of time it takes to get information transferred back and forth. Really cool thing about this SSD built onto this GPU is that you could actually use it as a system hard drive if you need it. AMD doesn't recommend doing this, but the option is available there. And of course, you can also extend the amount of video buffer you have to work with by allocating part of that 1 terabyte SSD as video memory too. I don't know what the actual amount of video memory is. It's probably, 64 gigabytes, maybe even 128. That's a piece of information I probably should have had in front of me. I just don't have it, and I do apologize for that. But you can expand that memory with this SSD that's already on the video card. That's just an insane idea. I don't know why no one's thought about it before. It probably has to do with the cost of SSDs in the beginning when they were first coming out. They have dropped significantly since then, and now we're seeing some really interesting uses for SSDs. In other storage news, we've got this brand new Seagate M.2 drive that's 2 terabytes. That's an insane amount of storage space in an M.2 drive. It was just last year that Samsung had released their top dog M.2 drive, and I forget its name, and I should be, shame on me for not having that information available to you right now. But it was at 512 gigabytes, half a terabyte. And now this year we've got an M.2 drive with 2 terabytes of storage space. It is insane. This SSD is available for enterprise use only at the present moment. I'm sure we'll be seeing consumer level versions of this SSD become available, and I cannot wait, because the access times with these M.2 drives are ridiculous. They're miles ahead of using the SATA 3 interface. Oh, and I should probably cover, what an M.2 drive actually is. M.2 is an interface standard for allowing manufacturers to use PCI Express lanes to transfer information as opposed to the SATA bus. If any of you are familiar with the SATA bus, it has reached its saturation point. We've got SATA 3, which allows us to access information at 600 megabytes per second, theoretically. With an M.2 drive, you can have speeds anywhere from 2,500 megabytes per second and up. That's an insane jump in access times. So as you can imagine, a lot of people will be pushing in this direction, because you're just going to get more insane speeds using M.2. It's nuts. I cannot wait to get my hands on my very first M.2 drive. I'll be sure to share that with you when that happens. Moving on to console news, we want to talk about first the Sega Genesis / Mega Drive Mini. Now, a few weeks ago, Nintendo had released information about them coming out with a Nintendo Mini, much to the joy of all of the people in the world. If you're like me, a child of the 90s, actually an 80s, a child of the 80s, but grew up in the 90s, you had a Nintendo Entertainment Center and you spent hours in front of the TV playing that. And there's a good chance you probably had a Sega Genesis there too. So with the news of the release of the Nintendo Mini, and then a week later, the news about this new Sega Genesis Mini getting released, everyone was going insane with retro happiness. But as it turns out, this Sega Genesis Mini is not all it's cracked up to be. It's actually made by a manufacturer in China called At Games. It's actually been around since 2012, and from what I've been reading, it is a slug of a machine. Apparently, it suffers from performance issues, especially with the response times between controller input and what you see on the screen. They've made a few upgrades to it in the past few years, but it's not Sega Genesis hardware. It's not made by Sega at all, so they're not quite hitting the nail on the head with this, apparently. It can play licensed games from Sega, as well as some third-party software from what I presume are Chinese developers. It's not terrible, but it's not authentic enough, I think, for a lot of us. You know, we were hoping that Sega was releasing this and that we'd get a lot of great old Sega Genesis games. But as it turns out, we're getting some Sega Genesis games and then some third-party games from China that I've never heard of. I think the reason why this jumped up on everybody's radar was because of the logo on the front of the box there. As you can see, it's a picture of Sonic and a 25th anniversary logo there too. That probably got a lot of people excited, and probably why the news of this release spread like wildfire when it came out. Of course, now the afterglow, everyone's finding out what's really going on with this. And I'm not going to say we're disappointed, but we're a little slighted. Now Nintendo NX. So there's some interesting things coming out about the Nintendo NX. So this mock-up here, courtesy of Eurogamer.net, kind of tells it all. So it looks like Nintendo NX, at least part of it, is going to be portable. And then there'll be a base station that you plug this tablet in. The tablet has two controllers that connect to it. You can detach those controllers, and then you'll be plugging it into the base unit. And I think this is all speculation at this point. I'll have to double-check my sources, and you should double-check me too. So the idea here is that the tablet portion of the Nintendo NX will be released first, late this year, they're speculating, and that the base unit will come out sometime early next year. And that's a real interesting strategy, and I'm not sure what the motivation is behind that, but we'll find out closer to launch, I'm sure. Some other interesting news about the Nintendo NX concerns the controllers. Apparently, in a patent filing, some studious observers saw that the Nintendo NX controllers actually add performance to the Nintendo NX. The way that Eurogamer described it was that the brains will be in the controller. Now, to me, that kind of indicates that they're going to be putting processor units in the controller. And I'm not sure that's actually what they're going to be doing. I suspect that they'll be adding memory in each of these controllers, and that the more controllers you add to your Nintendo NX, the better performance you can get. That's actually what it said in this patent filing. That's a real interesting take on improving performance on a system. We'll have to see how that pans out and see exactly what Nintendo has in mind. I should also mention that Nintendo decided to go with a NVIDIA Tegra processor instead of going the way of Sony and Microsoft and using AMD. It makes sense given that they're making part of this a tablet. The Tegra processor is a mobile-based processor. I actually have a NVIDIA Shield tablet that uses a Tegra processor. So I'm not at all surprised to see them go with this instead of with AMD. It'll be real interesting to see how the Nintendo NX turns out. I have hope that this will bring Nintendo back into the forefront of hardcore gamers. I'm really excited for the brand new Zelda game that's coming out on both the Wii U and the Nintendo NX. I just really hope they deliver this time on this console. Well, that wraps up this first episode of Hardware Corner. I want to thank you guys for joining me. Of course, I should have mentioned throughout the entire episode that all the information that I'm relaying to you comes from various websites that I visit often. You've got the WCCF Tech. I get a lot of hardware news from there, along with Game Rant, Kotaku, and a whole bunch of other websites that I love visiting. I'll have all those listed in the description below, so please check those out. Of course, let me know how I did with this episode. Tell me what you liked about it, what you didn't like about it. Of course, give us a like and a subscribe to Attack of the Nerds. Hopefully, we'll be coming up with more programming for you in the near future. Until then, I'll see you next time.